Noah's flood. According to Sumerian myth, only one person was permitted to enter this heavenly paradise. According to the Sumerian faith, only the immortal gods were permitted to enter paradise. Mortals were excluded. Consequently, the Sumerian Noah and the flood narrative contain the most remarkable resemblance to the Bible of any ancient text discovered. The biblical accounts of the flood are traditional. According to George Smith of the British Museum, the Hebrew writers of the Bible unearthed and interpreted the 11th tablet of the Sumerian Gilgamesh epic. The account of the Babylonian flood is derived from Sumerian mythology. In 1914, Arno Purbel published the bottom third of a six-column Sumerian tablet from the Nippur collection of the University Museum. His translation is essential and extensively utilized, even though Purbel is our only source. The flood narrative absorbs most of the text. No additional flood tablet fragments have been discovered in any excavation, museum, or private collection, despite the efforts of specialists. Cuneiformists might anticipate several surprises and hurdles in the future. A single tablet holding the contents of a flood episode is significant for the contents of the flood episode and the tablet's emphasis on floods. The same may be argued for the phrases before and following the flood narrative. These documents have several remarkable assertions about the genesis of man, the beginning of monarchy, and the presence of at least five primordial cities. These poems had an impact on Sumerian cosmology. Almost the whole tale is presented here with intriguing ambiguities and questions. It is impossible to identify the origin of myths in time. There is a gap of 37 lines in the lowest half of the whole tablet. Next, the divine approaches the other gods. He is presumably stating that he will preserve mankind, and as a consequence, humankind will build the cities and temples of the gods. Following the speech are three difficult-to-understand lines that detail the deity's acts to substantiate his remarks. The evolution of humans, animals, and plants begins in the following four lines. Overall, it seems as follows. I shall eradicate my humanity in the course of its extinction. I'll go back there to see Nintu. Using my pets, I shall restore the people to their dwellings. They will establish religious norms while I will offer them shade and tranquility. Their bricks will be used to build our dwellings in hygienic areas. Our decisions will be made in pristine environments. The pure fire was used to chill the water. Divine rules were strengthened and rituals were refined. He was influential in doing so on earth. Then he enacted the legislation. When Anu, Enlil, Enki, and Ninhursag created humans with black heads, the earth blossomed in leafy growth. The creatures with four legs on the plain were imaginatively designed. More than 37 verses indicate the creation of five cities and the fall of the heavenly kingdom. The regal throne was subsequently lowered from heaven and the high crown was removed. The ceremonial laws and rites of heaven have been adjusted. Construction of five clean cities. They were known as cult centers and had names. He gave the first of these positions to the commander Nudimud and the second to Budibira. Endur-Bilhursag handed him Larak, the third. Noah in Sumeria, the Flood, and the Ark, the University Museum's replica of Arno Purbel's flood tablet, is the only documentation of this tale. Utu was presented to the hero by Sipar the IV. The sixth, Sud-Shurupak, was handed to him as a gift. He categorized these cities as cult hubs after identifying them. The program, Cleaning of Small Rivers, was introduced to them by him. After a wait of 37 lines, the gods decide to release the flood and exterminate humankind. When the inscription is once again decipherable, many gods are enraged by the dreadful judgment. Ziusudra is the biblical equivalent of Noah. He is a god-fearing, devout monarch who often seeks heavenly insights via spells and dreams. The most extended piece of this chapter goes as follows. Ziusudra seems to station himself against a wall, where he hears the voice of a deity proclaiming the god's intention to send a flood and eradicate the germ of humankind. When the flood took place, Nintu cried incoherently. Pure Inanna penned lamentations for the people. Enki said, "This is pure Inanna." Ninhursag, Enki, and Enlil, both heaven and earth, spoke the names An and Enlil. Ziusudra, king of Pashishu. Huge structure. He performed with honor, decency, and modesty. He is always present. He conceived a variety of fancies. He announced the names of heaven and earth. The gods erected a barrier. Ziusudra stood by it and listened. "Stand to my left next to the wall. Accept my word for it and hear what I have to say against the wall. As a result of our activities, the cult centers will be inundated, destroying humanity's foundation. This is the conclusion, the divine commandment." Enlil and Anu carried out the directive. Its reign of terror will soon come to an end. Ziusudra must have been given comprehensive instructions in the book on how to construct a massive watercraft to save himself. Unfortunately, it was lost due to yet another 40-line break. Rereading the verse reveals that the flood had already ravaged the land for 7 days and nights. Ziusudra genuflects before the returning sun god Utu, presenting him with gifts as he distributes his precious light over the cosmos. Please review the following. The cult centers were inundated by floods and strong winds, 7 days and seven nights after the flood went across the nation. The boat was thrown about by storms on the ocean's enormous waves. He lit the sky and the ground, and Ziusudra opened the window of the large boat. Atu presented his beams to the enormous vessel as a gift. King Ziusudra demonstration before Utu. The monarch slaughters two animals, a sheep and an ox. Here is another gap of around 39 lines. The deification of Ziusudra is recounted in the last lines of our book. When he bowed before An and Enlil, he was given eternal life and transported to Dilmun, also known as the city where the sun rises. Anu and Enlil spoke breath of sky and breath of the earth. The lungs became larger. From the earth, vegetation grows. The king Ziusudra ruled the land. He raised an objection before An and Enlil. Both An and Enlil loved Ziusudra. It makes him look more realistic. The god they create for him will exist forever. Afterward, King Ziusudra took action. The protector of plant names and the seeds of humankind. They compelled them to dwell in the land of crossing where the sun rises, Dilmun. We need to know what happened to the transformed Ziusudra in the home of the immortals, as the remaining 39 lines of text on the tablet have been obliterated. As stated by the Sumerians, we are now leaving paradise for the powerful below, or the realm from whence there is no return. Descent to the underworld is one of the most well-preserved Sumerian legends. A restless goddess travels to the realm of the dead to satisfy her unbridled desires. This is an excellent analogy to one of the most significant New Testament subjects. In recent years, several historical and biblical discoveries have been unearthed that were not included or were misinterpreted in the canonical Bible. When ancient texts such as the Book of Enoch, the Nag Hammadi Gospels, and the Book of Jubilees are integrated with contemporary records, they provide a comprehensive view of the current Western culture's beliefs. Ancient literature not contained in the Bible enhances our knowledge of Middle Eastern history. This has had a profound effect on Western thought. In Mesopotamia's abandoned plains are hidden scrolls in lonely caves cuneiform tablets buried by the sands of time, and monuments precisely aligned to the solstice and equinox. Documents from this period predate the canonical Bible by millennia. Here, the narrative's origins and influences are explained. Is it surprising that Noah dwelt in the Sumerian capital of Noah's city, Shurippak? According to his memories of the past, he was well educated. In one of the most famous scenes involving the King of Uruk from the Epic of Gilgamesh, the King of Uruk pays a visit to Noah. During the conversation, he discusses many matters that are significant to them both. Sumer is situated between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers in southern Mesopotamia. Abraham was born there. Abram changed his name to Abraham when he made a covenant with the Lord. He was previously known as Abram. The Lord informed Abram in Genesis 12, 1-4, "The time has arrived for you to become the father of many nations. Follow me to the Anunnaki homeland. Leave behind your Anunnaki country, people, and your father's family. I'll demonstrate. Your country will flourish and I will bless you. Your reputation will grow and you will be favored. All Anunnaki on earth will be benefited as a result of your efforts." When God called Abram to Canaan, he was at Haran, a Sumerian city. In 1433 BCE, Abram was born in the Sumerian city of Ur. His father, Terah, was a local temple priest and artisan. His brothers Nahor and Haran also lived there. Abraham is preparing to leave Haran for Canaan when he reaches there. "The Lord sent you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land." Isn't the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob also the God of Israel in the Old Testament? In addition to Jehovah, Yahweh, and El Shaddai, Abraham adopted a Sumerian name for God in one of his temples at Ur. The Atrahasis, a significant additional source from Abraham's region and era, recognizes Abraham's divinity. According to cuneiform Anunnaki documents unearthed at Ur and several other pre- and post-diluvial sites along the Tigris and Euphrates, including Sippar and Nineveh, this Sumerian deity also worshipped brother and sister gods throughout Mesopotamia and the surrounding regions. As with Abraham and Noah, these deities had a close relationship with them. Can we identify them? What should we make of the fact that Abraham's deity was a Sumerian god with a temple in the Chaldean city of Ur? Precisely, the Roman Catholic Church controls and administers early archaeological project funding. In 325 AD, the same body issued a mandate mandating the sole funding of archaeological research consistent with the biblical narrative. As the seekers' interest rose, hidden books, artifacts, codices, cylinder seals, Sumerian tablets, and monuments inscribed in cuneiform revealed their secrets. The historical monument was commissioned by Darius I to commemorate the Persian king's suppression of rival rebellions between 522 and 486 BCE. In 1835, Sir Henry Rawlinson, a British military officer training the troops of the Shah of Iran, began investigating the inscription. Sir Henry Rawlinson discovered three distinct languages engraved into the rocks of Behistun, Iran in 1835. By scaling the rock, Rawlinson could duplicate the old Persian inscription despite its inaccessibility. As Behistun's name was anglicized, the stone became known as the Behistun inscription. The Elamites were on the other side of a chasm, while the Babylonians were 4 meters above us. Both were beyond our reach, leaving us with a task for later. After acquiring a third of the syllabary, Rawlinson started translating the Persian text using Grotefend's studies. This article's first part included a list of Herodotus's Persian rulers. In 1838, Rawlinson deciphered the old Persian cuneiform writing by matching names to symbols. he reported his findings to the Paris and London Royal Asiatic Societies. After deciphering the tablets, Major Rawlinson replicated the unique wedge-shaped inscriptions carved into the sheer rock face for the British Museum. The capacity to translate between Old Persian, Anunnaki Elamite, and Akkadian inscriptions permitted the rediscovery of Mesopotamian ruins buried under the sands of the Iraqi desert. By evaluating the eyewitness reports and data provided by the Egyptians, Sumerians, and early church writers, the historical reality, which is wilder than the most fantastical fiction, is revealed in novel ways. Several mysteries have been resolved thanks to discoveries in ancient towns from Nineveh to Eridu in the south. The origin myths created by ancient historians and scribes using factual facts serve as the cultural basis of our civilization. Due to their diligence, sweat, and blood, the first investigators discovered innumerable signs and presented them for everyone to see. When writing history, persons in positions of authority often put the truth on the back burner. The objective is to use a narrative to sustain the governing party's authoritarian control. Removing carved hieroglyphs to add the names and ranks of warring deities and assembling lists, commonly known as lists of names, further masked flagrant activities. First-person writers have questioned the veracity of works such as Enoch's book for thousands of years. Historical accuracy was questioned. Thus, the truth was left to those in authority. This was prevalent in the past when most people were illiterate. Throughout history, scribes and priests were often schooled in the linguistic arts, which provided them with a keen understanding of reality. Archaeologists have recently unearthed and deciphered tens of thousands of cuneiform tablets hidden for millennia under the sand and silt of the Anunnaki Mesopotamian plains and containing recorded secrets. In response to the discovery of thousands of clay tablets engraved in an ancient script, a cuneiform digitization effort was initiated to decipher the clay tablets' secrets. Sumerian antiquities, including cuneiform tablets, may be found in several museums in London, Paris, and Berlin. Bible writings are sometimes thousands of years older than Sumerian literature. Sumerian texts discovered at ancient sites like Uruk and the biblical Erech discuss marriage and commerce. They include more severe decree reports and Anunnaki birth, death, and other life event records. Due to the differences between actual historical records and those generated by societal winners, it is possible to synthesize concepts by comparing the contemporary foundation for cultural and social mores with their antecedent equivalents from several civilizations. According to the detailed account in the Book of Enoch, Noah's mysterious birth was weirder than fiction. Some scholars contend that Noah's father was not Lamech, as recorded in Genesis 5:28, but rather one of the Mesopotamian gods who protected him from the flood. The identical incident is told in the Bible, but no Sumerian specifics are provided. In the ancient Babylonian flood narrative, God converses with Zeusudra, commonly known as Noah, in his reed dwelling. This deity predicts a deluge on the Mesopotamian plains. Analyzing birth records, family trees, and Mesopotamian temple deities yields a shocking discovery. The cultural deception revealed by our current information base has such a significant effect on us that all we previously believed is wiped as if it were a conclusion we would not have arrived at. When Westerners are presented with Yahweh-related questions, they need a resolution. As the Old Testament and canonical Bible make clear, Jehovah is often added after God's declaration. The truth is exposed when it is found that Enlil, the local Anunnaki god of the Sumerian city of Ur, was really Yahweh, since Enlil is recorded in several Sumerian and other historical texts. Enlil and his progeny were revered as gods at several Anunnaki temples, including Nineveh, Assur, and Ur. His brothers, Enki, Nana, and Inanna, constructed temples at the cultural and economic hubs of the area. Enlil, unlike the Anunnaki, collaborated with other beings known as Nephilim or Elohim, according to Genesis 1:26, which contains the following unclear remark. "Let us build a Dapa in our image and likeness," God declares. The myth of Noah's flood, or Atrahasis, connects the same Anunnaki gods worshipped in Near Eastern temples to the Old Testament's Enlil Yahweh and his brother Enki Adonai, the Us concealed in Genesis 1:26. In a genetic experiment, Enki and his half-sister Ninma create Homo sapiens, a non-civilized laborer. Reading works that precede Genesis by more than 1,700 years, such as the Atrahasis, addresses the misunderstanding produced by the plural pronoun us, our, in the biblical narrative of creation. The outcomes of therapeutic trials applying the archetype of the human species are particular. Enlil's half-sister, Ninhursag or Ninma, and his competing and more technically oriented brother Enki conducted the experiment in an African laboratory. In contrast to the Bible's correct story, which is often supplementary, this work provides a more comprehensive account of the creation of man that makes considerably more sense in terms of technical and historical considerations. In a document approximately 5,000 years old, researchers have the knowledge required to discuss a topic like genetic engineering. Similar texts provide insight into the biblical Noah, King Utnapishtim of Shurupak, who was 600 years old during the flood. Numerous deities have been known by various names for a very long period. Inanna, his sister, had temples across Mesopotamia and wore the crescent moon emblem. She was known by the Akkadians as Ishtar. Other Sumerian locations, like Ur and Haran, were named after Nana, Enlil's son and the moon god. The Ionian Greek historian Herodotus flourished in the 5th century BCE. Egyptologists continue to use it to categorize the dynasties of Egyptian culture. Manetho, an Egyptian priest historian, agreed with Herodotus's classification of Egypt's dynasties into three, but he added a fourth dynasty ruled entirely by the gods. According to Manetho, the first heavenly dynasty of ancient Egypt reigned for 12,300 years. The exceptionally extended reigns of the early monarchs of the Egyptian dynasty are highlighted again. According to Sumerian scriptures, Anu gave the continents of Egypt and Africa to Enki, a mighty god from Eridu, circa 3860 BCE. The Jewish astrological calendar, which has its roots in the Sumerian city of Nippur and the Anunnaki, started counting in 3760 BCE by happenstance. Although it seems to be a coincidence, ancient cuneiform inscriptions demonstrate otherwise. According to Manetho, 12 celestial monarchs governed Egypt for 1,570 years under the Second Dynasty. Thoth, Enki's son, was the Second Dynasty's first deity. For 3,650 years, 30 demigods governed Egypt. It is believed that the 350-year Pharaonic dynasty began about 3,100 BCE. Its capital was Memphis, or in Greek, Men-Nefer. Where did these deities originate? The Sumerian kings list further confuses the mystery's hints. According to historical records, some of Sumer's first monarchs reigned for up to 28,800 years. That is almost incomprehensible. Sin is represented through several traditions, such as those linked with Assyria and the crescent moon image used on Islamic flags and mosques. Several monuments, like the Temple of Hathor in the god Nana desert, are devoted to the Sumerian goddess Inanna, also known in Egypt as Hathor. The Egyptians venerated Inanna, also known as Hathor, while the Mesopotamians venerated the moon deity Nanarsin. The ancestry of Nanarsin, revered as the moon deity by ancient Middle Easterners and identified as the son of Enlil in Sumerian records, was inscribed in baked clay. According to history, Nanarsin had a massive following that travelled from southern Iraq through Syria, Turkey, and Iran to visit his cult sites. What does the expression Nanarsin mean? Nanarsin was perhaps the deity Muhammad met in the forest. The Kaaba stone in Mecca, Saudi Arabia, a Muslim holy site, was once devoted to the local manifestation of Allah, the moon god. When referring to a deity, changing one proper noun results in replacing another. A new epithet replaces the previous one. Comparisons in Lamentations of Ur between the Old Testament god of vengeance and the Sumerian storm god demonstrate this, Enlil. Abraham and the citizens of Ur, which eventually became the Anunnaki city-state El Shaddai, were eyewitnesses to the Sumerian god Enlil, whose origins were unknown, but whose daily presence was recorded and documented in the Bible. Jehovah was a stunning revelation for the Israelites, linking the Sumerian deities to at least one Old Testament deity. In other locations, well-known deities like Enki and Ahura Mazda, the god of light and intelligence, were worshipped. When Arab forces toppled the Persians in 633 BCE, they replaced Ahura Mazda with Nanarsin in Persepolis, the Persians' magnificent capital. The downfall of Zoroastrianism during the Arab invasion in 644 BCE. Egyptian and Sumerian names and epithets were often combined to symbolize dominance and power. To accommodate the worshipper's language and culture, a name was created by combining many names. It was done so that it would be easier to refer to competitors and get information at any time. Considering that what one culture refers to as a god, another culture refers to as a different title, especially if the phrase can be tracked across civilizations, the possibility of an Anunnaki story becomes even more impressive. The validity of political and religious viewpoints in society is determined in the same way as the historian of truth is determined by the dominant forces. Instead of the politically unacceptable term lying, the winners and others' opinions are regarded as myths. The governing party or superpower maintains that subservient, pagan, or occult civilizations are the wellspring of religious truth. Whether natural or untrue, based on belief or ideology, the armies of the world's generals have once again assembled in the Middle East. Enlil and Enki, as well as their offspring, are shown as having battled in the Anunnaki Gods trilogy by Ryan Moorhen. Could this explain the ongoing confrontations between Israel, Syria, Iran, and Iraq? Will Enki's descendants prevent the evil scheme of Enlil, Zeus to the Greeks, and Ninurta, Apollo to the Greeks? Jesus was not acknowledged as the Messiah because he was a descendant of Jehovah's enemy, Enki. It is crucial to comprehend the relationship between the term heaven and the planet with Anunnaki origins. According to Sumerian scholars, Unar-ki signifies heaven to earth. It is designated as An. In 1996, Moorhen produced a study about Nibiru. Anu, the father of the central characters Enlil and Enki, presided over the 12-member Anunnaki Council, according to Mesopotamian literature such as the Epic of Gilgamesh. Ni-bi-ru may be written with three syllables in digital cuneiform. As a result, Anu deployed or sent the Anunnaki to Earth. When Enlil met Zeusudra for the first time on Mount Ararat, he addressed his people as Anunna. Consequently, Anua is an alternative spelling of Anunna. Similar to how Nibiru was provided as an example, the cuneiform script provides its own set of uniform hexadecimal codes. When re-examining prayers such as Our Father who art in heaven, which throws fresh light on the Father in heaven, namely Anu, it is imperative to understand Nibiru in the context of the biblical term heaven. Enlil, Enki, Ninmar or Ninhursag, one of his earthly descendants, was required to appeal. Why did the Anunnaki depart from Nibiru and go to Earth? Sumerians resided on the brown dwarf Nibiru, according to maps uncovered in Anunnaki kingdoms and observations from the Iras Naval Observatory. Mount Graham's staunchly Catholic orientation employs the Lucifer scope to monitor the coming of Nibiru. Nibiru orbits the Sun in a retrograde elliptical orbit 3,600 years after Pluto. Nibiru has come already. Why would a civilization from Nibiru with sophisticated technology send scientists to Earth? Environmental constraints and the continuing political power struggle on Nibiru drew the attention of the governing council. Solar energy often reaches planets in their farthest orbits. Due to their ideal distance from the Sun, brown dwarfs do not get as much solar energy to sustain an acceptable surface temperature as Earth does. The atmosphere of Nibiru is formed by geothermal heat or manufactured gases and steam. During perigee, the atmosphere is exposed to the most significant amount of radiation. According to Sitchin's verifiable historical chronology, life on Nibiru was on the point of extinction around 450,000 years ago, due to a deteriorating atmosphere and exposure to radiation. At Nibiru's near perigee to the Sun, the circumstance was challenging. Anu overthrows the wicked king Alalu, sends him into exile, and seizes the Nibiru throne. Alalu flees the planet on a spaceship to save money for his exile. Alalu utilizes his finding of rare metal as a peace gift in his quest to defend Nibiru's atmosphere. By releasing ionized particles of gold into the planet's dissolving atmosphere, the ionization shield will protect the planet from solar radiation. Enki, Anu's scientifically inclined son, is tasked with determining the likelihood of locating fabled gold on Earth. Enki, who had previously determined that a Niburian year was equivalent to 3,600 Earth years, returned to Earth 445,000 years later. According to Sumerian chronicles, including the Sumerian Kings List, Eridu, located near the headwaters of the Persian Gulf, was the first city inhabited by the Anunnaki. Enki and a small contingent of backup soldiers started gold mining in the Gulf of Mexico shortly after their arrival on Earth. Enlil, the younger son of Anu, is dispatched to assist Enki in accelerating the gold recovery process. Enki and Enlil sent Anu to Earth to supervise the troublesome mining operation, since they had the infrastructure to crush rocks and process gold-bearing ore. Enki relocated the ore mining activity from the Persian Gulf to the Zambezi River in South Africa. Anu came to Earth between 445,000 and 360,000 years ago, and his son Enki briefed him on the current state of gold mining. Their debate centered on which brother would oversee the mining activities in Africa and the Mesopotamian command center, particularly Nippur. In the legend of Atrahasis, Anu, Enlil, and Enki drew lots to choose which mission they would follow individually, dividing the two often feuding half-brothers. According to Sumerian legend, Enki was the eldest son of Anu and Antu, while Enlil was their rightful heir. The male's offspring and half-sister are the lawful heirs according to Niburian inheritance laws. The Anunnaki performed this action based on their scientific understanding. The presence of mitochondrial DNA in the female genetic contribution predisposes the bloodline to maternal descent, but the absence of mitochondrial DNA in the male genetic contribution does not. In the Temple of Ur, Terah and his son Abram would eventually serve Enlil, the king of Mesopotamia. Inanna, Anu's favorite granddaughter, was given the Indus Valley, while the Sinai Peninsula was handed to the Anunnaki. The split began in 3760 BCE and ended in the same year. Enki was sent to Abzu, Africa, to expedite gold mining and rehabilitate the decaying ecology of the Niberians. Enki returned to Nibiru to assume the role of king. In space, Niburian astronauts need medical assistance. Ninhursag, the half-sister of Enki and a physician, landed on Earth 415,000 years ago and opened a clinic in Shurupak. The Anunnaki criticized Nibiru's seeming youth in comparison to their own. On Earth, their cycles were shorter than Nibiru's, which lasted 3,600 years. After Enki's arrival, Sumeria extended the Eridu he had previously constructed. These cities had the infrastructure necessary for communication with Nibiru, mining activities, and ore processing. The existence of ancient astronauts throughout history is essential to the background knowledge. 300,000 years ago, the Anunnaki Council of Twelve convened in the Enki area of southern Africa to enhance gold production rates. The highest-ranking members of the Anunnaki Council, probably Enki himself, transported slaves to Earth. Despite being called working-class agents, they were far more intelligent than humans. The watchers of the miners are referred to as Igigi in the Lost Book of Enoch.